All right, let's take up the issue of the letter and the photographs and your offer of proof, sir, if you have one.
Okay, I don't need no offer of proof.
I'll ask you a second time. Do you have an offer of proof to provide, sir?
We can go past all that. I don't need to ask them questions. It's too much of an issue. It's too much of a problem.
Mr. Brooks, I'm going to ask you for a third time. Do you have an offer of proof related
to the route? I just said that.
All right, thank you. Then based upon there being no offer of proof, then my decision stands. As to the continuation of the examination of Ms. Patterson, I would like an offer of proof as to what you believe her probative and relevant testimony will be from this point forward.
I mean, I don't know how she's going to answer the rest of the questions. There's not that many questions left. I was almost done.
What topics generally were you going to question her about?
I guess I'll have to look in here because so much that happened since over the past hour and a half or so. I can tell you one thing, I don't intend to have too many more questions. I tell you that. I was almost finished.
I need an offer of proof as to what you believe her testimony would be, meaning what topics? And are they topics that have not already been covered either through her direct examination from the state, your cross-examination, or already covered by your direct?
I don't remember her. What do you mean by related to her direct? Is that from the last time she testified?
From the first date that she testified and from today.
I don't remember everything she testified to the first time. It was 2 weeks ago.
Well, she's already been questioned now twice by you. So what new topics do you intend to question her about when she comes back on the witness stand?
What do you mean by new topics?
Topics that you haven't already covered.
What, to pursuant to the police report or something? Is that what you're asking?
No,
I don't understand.
I'm asking you what you believe your questioning will be as to Ms. Patterson going forward.
And you say it related to topics, right?
You can just give me the topics. I think that's fair.
I wanted to ask questions about the police reports. That was the last few questions. That's why I'm saying it was only...
Is it a statement that she wrote?
I don't know if it's a statement that she wrote in here.
Do you see a written statement with her signature on it?
I don't have to go through all the paperwork.
Is there a written statement from Ms. Patterson?
No, Your Honor.
It's my understanding Detective Guth spoke to her on both occasions. Is that right?
Yes, with Detective Barron with him on the first occasion. Detective Barron wrote that first report.
What about the police report, sir, do you want to question her about so I know with specificity?
How many officers did reports? Because it seemed like it's more than just two. At least from this paperwork, it's more than two.
May I have a to show me what
Mr. Brooks is referring to? I can maybe help him try and explain, but
sure.
I don't know what he's talking about.
I can't find the first page to that, but whoever that officer is right there. I have to snatch it.
So I've got
pages 2 and 3 out of 6 from Detective Barron's report under Waukesha Police Department incident number 21-047533. This is one of the two reports we've been talking about regarding the statements that Ms. Patterson gave to detectives on November 21st and then on November 22nd. This is the first statement.
Is that the officer you just said?
Yes.
What about that report do you want to question this witness about?
The report is not in order, so... Again, as I stated before, I would have to read it.
Mr. Brooks, I trust that you're prepared. These are your witnesses. So what questions, what about that report do you want to question Ms. Patterson on?
Your Honor, I just stated three times I would have to read a little bit of this to form the questions.
Under my authority, under 90611, then, and given that this witness was initially called by the state, there was a full and fair opportunity for cross-examination by Mr. Brooks at that time, and they had ample time this morning to question her. I will declare that his questioning of her to be closed. I will bring the witness out on the witness stand and then we'll bring the jury out, and then I will simply ask the state if there are any questions, and then we'll move on from there.
Just so I understand, what do you mean by closed?
I'm not allowing you to ask her any additional questions, given your full and fair opportunity that you had previously when she was called by the state, and given the opportunity you had this morning and your failure to identify for this court any probative and relevant information that she would testify to about what's in that report.
First of all, the report isn't even in order. So I would have to essentially read at least some of it to even ask a question.
Mr. Brooks, this is your witness. I expect that you will be prepared and you will not cause delay by any lack thereof. So I'm bringing the witness out. The jury will come out, and you will not have another opportunity to ask any additional questions unless the state asks questions on cross-examination.
So what is we bringing the witness out for?
I have to do that in front of the jury.
Man, this. I object to that ruling, too. Can you give me a lawful law why?
Your objection is noted for the record. If you start interrupting me when the jury comes out or make any commentary, you will be removed to the other courtroom and you will, and that's.
So I'm being held in contempt again?
No, it's not contempt, sir. It's a finding under Illinois versus Allen. It's a warning that you will forfeit your right
to
be present.
I might as well have just stayed over there then if I was going to be held in contempt.
That decision is for you and you alone to make, and it is based on your conduct. If you're going to continue.
Just take me over there because I'm not going to get held in contempt for nothing.
I have not held you in contempt.
You did. You're attempting to hold me in contempt. That's what that is.
No, that's not contempt.
So is it civil or criminal? Why am I being held in contempt?
That's the whole reason I didn't want to call the next witness, and I'm going to need to bring you over in any event.
That's the whole reason why I didn't want to come over here, because you was going to find a reason to hold me in contempt.
Well, I'm finding a reason, and it's not contempt, but I'd find a reason to remove you based upon your disruptive outbursts.
Well, then remove me if that's what you want to do. Remove me then.
I don't want to do it, sir.
Obviously, you do.
This courtroom.
Obviously, you do. You brought it up before we can even get to.
All right. Mr. Brooks has forfeited his right to be present in this courtroom for the remainder of this witness.
Did I actually forfeit that right?
You have forfeited your right to be present.
And how did I forfeit that right, Your Honor?
All right. We're going off the record so that he can be removed to the other courtroom, and he can call his next witness after we complete with Ms. Patterson and giving the state an opportunity from the neighboring courtroom. And once you can promise to this court that you will abide by the rules of decorum and civility, and if you're willing to conduct yourself consistently within that, then I will allow you to come back over.
So why am I being held in contempt now?
I'm not holding you in contempt.
Then what did I do?
All right, I'm gonna step off. You've interrupted repeatedly. You are unmuted, sir. The jury is on its way in. Well, we'll be shortly.
Why didn't we address subject matter jurisdiction when I was over here?
I'm going to mute you if you do that, sir.
I'm not going to do it when the jury out. That's why I asked now before the jury came in.
I addressed that in my opening type remarks and record when we came back on the record today. I already addressed that.
So will it be proven for the record? Will I at least be told why I'm held in contempt when I didn't do nothing? Civil or criminal?
That's a misstatement of what I did, sir.
So why am I?
I will advise when the jury's coming in, and if you can't be quiet, you're going to be muted, sir.
You're going to mute me anyway.
Not if you're quiet.
So I got to be quiet like a little kid?
It's not what I said, sir. You have to be respectful.
That's what you said.
You have to be respectful of the proceedings.
But nobody has to be respectful to me, though.
That's a mischaracterization as well.
So can I say for the record that two of your bailiffs was just making gestures behind my head, and I seen them through the TV screen and made me feel uncomfortable.
Jury's coming in. Please rise for the jury.
So that's not going to be addressed.
Okay? Mr. Brooks, I'm muting you. Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. Just for the record, Mr. Brooks is appearing from another courtroom. That should not affect your deliberation or verdicts in any way. At this time, does the state have any questions for this witness?
I don't have any questions for Ms. Patterson.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. You may step down. Thank you for being here. All right, the defense may call its next witness, please. Go ahead, sir, you can call your next witness.
I thought I was muted.
You're not muted.
So how long am I supposed to stay here now?
I'm gonna excuse the jury. We'll help hopefully have you back shortly. All right, the jury is no longer in the courtroom. Do you wanna come back into this courtroom as you call your next witness? You're not muted. You're unmuted.
So what's going on now? Why am I being held in contempt yet again?
The record will reflect that pursuant to Illinois versus Allen, Mr. Brooks was not held in contempt. I found that you forfeited your right to be present based upon your conduct. I'd also direct the parties to some persuasive authority from other jurisdictions that are more recent, including People versus Cone from the state of Colorado, 160 P. 3rd, 366. It's a Colorado Court of Appeals from 2007. And then from the state of Washington, from their Supreme Court, State versus Davis, 461 P. 3rd, 1204. That's from 2020. And then I'd remind the parties of the district court decision that was later affirmed from Pennsylvania, U.S. versus Jennings, 855 F. 1427 from 1994. The finding was, sir, that you forfeited your right to be present based upon your conduct.
Okay, and all those case laws you just cited are pursuant to that.
Sir, I will ask you, would you like to come back into this courtroom as you continue with the calling of witnesses and your next witness?
I thought you was using Illinois versus Allen.
You are welcome to come back into this courtroom, sir.
So why was I removed in the first place then?
I've made my findings, the record will stand. I will ask you one last time. Would you like to come back into this courtroom as you call your next witness?
You're not finna hold me in contempt no more. Not finna do that.
Mr. Brooks is not answering my question directly, so based upon that, I'll advise him that if I will ask one more time and he fails to answer it with a yes or no, I will take that as a no, that he wants to stay in that courtroom.
You can't answer
Mr.
for
Brooks,
me. You can't do that.
Mr. Brooks, I'm advising you that I will... He's interrupting me once again.
Okay, you talking. You the one talking right now, so don't do that.
I'm going to mute him because he's not being respectful and he's just spouting off. I will give him one more opportunity so that it's abundantly clear on this record that I am honoring his right to be present, and I will unmute him. Sir, would you like to come back into this courtroom as you call your next witness?
Don't try to seem like you're trying to honor my rights now because you haven't
okay,
been doing
he it is, again, not answering the question
directly.
I'm going to mute him again. Mr. Brooks, before I unmute you, I am going to advise you. I will ask you to call your next witness. And if I don't get a direct response out of you, I may ask it again. And if you fail to give me a direct response, then you will forfeit your right to call any other witnesses. So I'm going to unmute you. Actually, I need to bring the jury back out. But before I do that, I will unmute you first and ask you which witness you intend to call so we can at least have that person ready to go and outside the courtroom. Who will be your next witness?
I'm not calling no witness if I got to be in this other courtroom.
Would you like to come back into this courtroom, sir?
Why was I ever removed? You never answered.
I've made a record of that, sir.
I have to answer everything, though. Everything you ask me, you expect me to answer. But then when I ask you questions, you never have to answer anything. I just put on the record that two of your bailiffs just made gestures. When I'm looking at them off the reflection of the screen, they're making gestures behind my head that make me feel uncomfortable. I just brought that up on the record. You didn't even address that.
Mr. Brooks, I didn't address it because, frankly, you keep interrupting me, and then I have to deal with the interruptions and make a record regarding that. So I just saw the captain walk over. I will let security personnel, Captain Dussault, look into that, and if appropriate, he can bring that conduct to my attention. I'd also remind the defendant that at any time, you can also ask to be brought over through the bailiffs who are in that courtroom. So to be abundantly fair to you, I will ask one more time, would you like to come back over to this courtroom?
I should have never been removed.
That's not answering my question, sir.
You haven't answered my question.
The court's not going to answer questions directed at the court by the defendant because they're not relevant or probative at this time, and they're a delay and disruptive tactic.
Mr. Brooks. They're not a delay and disruptive tactic. Is that a judicial determination that you're making?
I'm going to mute you because we're going off on the judicial determinations. Every decision I make, sir, is by definition a judicial determination. It is on the record. If there is a conviction, you can raise whatever issues you want on appeal if you are convicted. But we don't need to have this back and forth every time to further make the record when the record speaks for itself. I would like you to be present. That is always what I want during this case. It certainly, I think, is important. But you can forfeit your right to be present by your conduct, which you have done repeatedly throughout this case. I will advise you that if you are in that courtroom, because I have put you there and you have not reclaimed the right to be present by number one asking and then expressing a willingness to conduct yourself consistently with the decorum and respect inherent in the concepts of courts and judicial proceedings, you will remain over there. And it looks like he took his headphones off, so I will. Mr. Brooks, I'm advising you that if you fail to call a witness, you will forfeit your right to present any additional witnesses. And I'm doing this outside the presence of the jury right now for a reason. I need to know from you right now, you are unmuted. Who is your next witness?
She trying to say something to me, Jim.
What you trying to say?
That was very disrespectful, sir. You chose to take off your headphones?
Yeah, because I'm muted. So why am I going to have my headphones on and I'm muted?
Well, I would think your headphones help you hear. The muting is so that I don't have to hear the disruptions.
Okay, well, then why should I need to hear what you're
saying? So let me be clear, sir. And you are not.
You don't gotta be clear nothing. I don't gotta listen to you.
I will ask you one last time, sir. Who is your next witness?
First of all, is she talking to me again? We gotta keep doing this little childish stuff, dude. I got to sit up here and I'm supposed to abide by every single rule, but don't nobody else got to do that.
The record should reflect that Mr. Brooks is spouting off, making unsubstantiated allegations against this court, directly attacking the integrity of this court and these proceedings, while yet refusing to answer simple questions. Mr. Brooks, you are...
That's not my name. I told you I don't consent to being called that name.
Sir, you are hereby advised this is the last time I will ask this question.
Don't talk
or you will forfeit your right to present any additional witnesses.
Show me where that's law.
Because you are not cooperating with this process.
Show me that it's law. That's all I'm asking. Show me that it's lawful law.
Mr. Brooks.
How can I forfeit not being able to have a defense? Are you kidding me?
All I'm asking is that you conduct yourself with dignity, with decorum, and with respect. I will gladly bring you back into this courtroom so you can present your additional witnesses. You need to ask me to come back into this courtroom.
With all due respect, I'm tired of having this back and forth with you every day. It's not my intention to come in here and have this, these interactions with you every day. It's not. Regardless to what you may think, regardless to how you may feel, that is not my intention.
Okay?
I simply do what I do because I do not have the understanding. So if I don't understand something, I'm going to ask a question. I apologize if it makes you feel that I'm intentionally trying to delay the proceeding. If I'm intentionally trying to be disruptive. Because that's not the case. And I feel very, 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 very disrespected every time the record is made, making it seem like that's what I'm attempting to do. So of course it's gonna make it's gonna frustrate. Of course it's gonna make me a little bit upset. And I just want you to understand that. It seems to me the way I'm interpreting what you're doing, which is it is your courtroom. That's not it. That's not a dispute. That's not up for debate. You control what's going on in there. That's not a dispute. But the way I'm interpreting what you're doing is that I'm being held in contempt. That's how I'm interpreting. Because one of the three things that's cited in the Illinois versus Allen, one of them is being gagged. I haven't been gagged. One of them is held in contempt.
What's the third, Mr. Brooks? What's the third?
The third is removed from the courtroom while the trial continues, right? That's the third, right?
And is that's what's been done.
Okay. So now where does it say after that?
Where does it say after that?
That having me on a headset or being able to see and hear and all this and this, how is that not prejudicing my defense?
Sir, you can raise that issue on appeal. You can raise that issue on appeal if you are convicted.
This is why I say that, though, because I can't even see. The only thing I can see right now when I'm looking at the TV
is you
in the prosecution table. I can't see anything else.
I understand that, sir. I'm fully aware of that.
So I'm not fully aware of what's going on in the courtroom. Don't I deserve that right to be able to see and hear everything that's going on?
If you can conduct yourself consistently with the decorum and respect inherent in the concepts of courts and judicial proceedings, the answer then is yes. So I'm not going to have a debate with you about the law. Would you like to come back into this courtroom?
Are you going to kick me out?
Sir, I'm asking the questions right now. Would you like to come back into this courtroom? Yes or no?
Are you going to kick me out?
Sir, it's a yes or no question. Would you like to come back into this?
Well,
my answer was based on the reason why I'm answering like that. Because the moment I say something, it's going to get me put out. I don't want to keep hauling this stuff back and forth and back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. It wastes time, really.
I'm well aware of that, sir. That it delays the proceedings.
But then it's laid at my feet as if that's my attempt. You think I want to be over here?
Sir, I don't know what you want or don't want at this time. I know that we need to complete this trial and that you have frustrated today more than ever before the ability of this court to do that.
I apologize for you feeling that way, but I'm frustrated too. And nobody seems to take that into account. I'm just as frustrated as everybody. Probably more.
Then I suggest that you conform your conduct to the requirements of courtesy and decorum so that you don't run the risk of forfeiting your right to be present. But that falls on you and you alone, sir.
There is no conduct. I don't understand what you mean by that. I really don't.
Mr. Brooks, you may not understand it. I don't think that's accurate. I think you know exactly what you're doing.
If that's what you think, that's fine.
And you have demonstrated throughout this case that you pay attention to witnesses' testimony, that you make cogent and coherent objections. At times that you have even had evidence suppressed in this case or stricken.
It's not fair.
Are you self-represented? Absolutely. Does that present difficulties and disadvantages? Absolutely. But that takes me back to when you waived your right to counsel, and you did so knowingly, freely, voluntarily, and with a full understanding of the disadvantages and advantages of doing so. Meaning advantages of having an attorney, the disadvantages of doing it on your own, and you made a deliberate decision to represent yourself, and that comes at a risk to you of, yes, at times, not fully understanding the law, the rules of evidence, the rules of procedure, but you do so at your peril.
That's not fair to state, Your Honor, because...
So I'm going to do the following, since I'm not really getting anywhere. I'm going to mute you for the moment. I'm not getting anywhere with him. I would like him to be brought over, and he has a choice to make. He can come back over or he doesn't. Either way, he's going to be asked to call a witness in front of the jury. I will ask him three times if he fails to give me a direct answer, and after the third time, I will make the appropriate finding, but I will do that outside the presence of the jury. But we are going to continue, so we'll go off the record and he will come back over here. Thank you. We are in recess until that happens. The jury will be brought out and you'll be asked to call your next witness.
Being called their name.
So noted.
And we still need to address subject matter jurisdiction. Before the jury's brought out.
I will not be doing that.
Will it be proven for the record?
The record stands.
So is that a tacit agreement that you don't have to answer that question, Your Honor?
I make no such agreements with you, sir.
So that means you can answer a question then. Will we be addressing subject matter jurisdiction on the record? And will it be verified and proven? Non-responsive answer is a tacit agreement, Your Honor.
Jury's coming out.
All right.
The defense may call its next witness.
Who's here?
Bertram, Hayes, Aldrich, and Lestano are present and ready, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Let's go with Deanna Aldrich.
Deanna Aldrich? All right, very well.
Good afternoon, Ms. Aldrich. Direct your attention. Well, first of all, let me back up a little bit. What do you currently do for a living?
I'm retired.
That's always pretty good. Direct your attention to the evening of November 21 of 2021. Do you recall that evening pretty good?
Yes.
Where were you staying at the time?
I live on Maple Avenue.
And during that evening, did you hear anything unusual?
I did.
And do you recall what that was?
I heard a large
thumping noise in my neighbor's yard. And when I came out to my porch, I saw a red SUV.
Back up a little bit to the thumping noise. Can you describe that thumping noise? Would it just be a thumping? Did it sound like a crash or anything of that nature?
I believe it was like the engine dropping kind of noise.
Okay. And you stated you looked out your patio and saw a red SUV?
I did.
Do you recall how that SUV looked at that time?
It was smashed to smithereens.
And what did you see from that point?
Before I seen it shut off, I seen it go forward in the driveway and then back up like 3 feet. And then someone got out of the car and ran around the bushes to the front of my building.
And who's the someone that you are referring to?
At that time, I didn't have my glasses on, so I could not see clearly.
Do you recall a height?
I think he was probably anywhere between 5'6" and 6 foot. I really couldn't tell because of the angle.
So I'm assuming then your patio is kind of on a upward base type of angle that you would have kind of been looking sort of down.
I was looking down, yes. Okay.
Did you at any time observe this individual jump over the hood?
I was running in and out of my house, so I did not see because I was trying to find my glasses as I was running in and out.
So is it fair to say you were trying to locate your glasses so you can get a better look at what you were observing?
Yes.
Do you recall if the SUV had any tinted windows?
I do not recall.
And before that evening, had you ever noticed that SUV before that evening?
No.
Do you recall the name of the officer that interviewed you?
No.
No further questions at this time.
Thank you. Any cross?
No cross, Your Honor. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. You may step down. Defense may call its next witness.
The defense calls Christopher Bertram.
All right, thank you. Go ahead, sir. Your witness.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Go ahead, your witness.
First of all, good afternoon. What do you currently do for a living?
I do electrical work.
Directing your attention to the evening of November 21st, 2021. Do you recall that evening pretty well?
Not very.
Do you recall what you were doing that evening?
Yes.
And what were you doing that evening?
Taking my mother's car to our mechanic friend.
Were you aware of a parade going on that evening?
No.
Around what time were you taking your mom's car to be inspected?
I don't recall.
Do you recall seeing anything that caught your attention that evening?
Yes.
Can you state what that was?
A smashed up red car.
At the time you observed this smashed up car, as you say, did you see anyone driving it?
Yes.
And Were you able to make a description? Sorry. Description of who was driving it?
I believe so.
And what do you recall?
I don't recall what I said.
You don't recall what you said or saw?
I don't recall what I exactly said when I gave my statement.
Do you recall what you saw?
No.
Do you recall if the law enforcement officer was writing down what you were telling them or recording?
I don't recall.
Did you observe the vehicle stop at any point in time?
No.
So it was pretty much you just saw it just kind of just rolling past?
Yes.
Did you notice if the vehicle had any tints?
Any what?
Tints, like tinted windows?
No.
Do you recall stating during the interview that evening that you observed the driver as a black male with short hair and a short beard?
I don't recall exactly what I said.
Do you recall stating at any time during that interview that evening that you believe you saw the operator of the vehicle reach down and grab something as they were driving past?
Yes.
Did you ever see what you believe was being grabbed?
No.
And what did you think at that moment that you saw the operator of this vehicle reach down?
I was unsure.
And where did you observe the vehicle go after it had passed you?
I turned away after it passed me.
Do you recall what the operator of the vehicle was wearing at the time that it passed you?
I do not remember.
Do you recall during your interview with law enforcement that evening stating that you thought the operator was wearing a black sweater or jacket as it drove past you?
If that is what is written.
Do you recall saying that?
No.
Do you recall seeing the vehicle that you observed crash into anything?
No.
At some time after observing this vehicle, did you call 911?
Yes.
Do you recall around what time you called 911?
No.
Do you recall shortly after seeing this vehicle texting anyone?
Yes.
Do you recall who that was?
My girlfriend.
And what did you tell her?
I don't remember.
Do you recall telling her there's a shooting?
Possibly.
Did you see anyone else in the vehicle?
No.
But you do recall seeing the operator wearing a black sweater?
I don't remember.
Did you observe at any time that evening seeing someone run from the vehicle?
No.
Do you recall why you would have gave a description that evening when initially interviewed by law enforcement?
Because I saw the person in the car.
And how did that person look?
I don't remember.
Grounds?
Well, his answer may stand.
What was the answer?
He said, I don't recall, or I don't remember.
No further questions at this time.
Thank you. Any cross?
No.
Thank you, sir. You may step down, and you are excused. All right, go ahead, call your next witness.
And when we get to the next break, I have something discussed outside of the presence of the jury that pleases the court.
Do you want to do that now or after your next witness?
We can.
All right. I'll address a legal issue, and we'll bring the jury back in when we're ready. I'll rise for the jury, please. Everyone can have a seat, and then we'll just wait for the door to close. Go ahead, Mr. Brooks.
I'm curious. Some of these, judging by the reports, how are some of these answers allowed to pass when they're coming straight from reports made by the people on the stand? Very curious.
I don't understand your question. Are you? I'm not sure what you're asking me.
What I'm asking is, reading from the report that the people on the stand are giving, the report that they gave to law enforcement.
If you're asking me whether there's a mechanism in the rules of evidence and how to establish that before the jury, the answer to that is yes. If you're asking me how you do that, I'm not going to answer that.
I didn't ask how. I just, to be blunt, which I've been since the beginning of this trial, obviously, I see the whole strategy here by the prosecution. I see right through it. Don't have any cross-examination. Mainly because you've already schooled the people getting on the stand on how to answer certain things.
Well, that is completely speculative on your part without any basis in law or fact.
It's obvious.
Sir, you could ask questions that establish that. You can ask them if they've met with anyone. You haven't done that. So for you to say that right now is without basis.
It's clear.
If you are looking to elicit what they said in the report, there is a way under the rules of evidence based upon the way the witnesses have answered to clarify that. But that requires you to call certain witnesses. I'm not going to give you any more legal advice further than that.
I don't think I have to
so
call any other witnesses. That's
if you're
not
asking me to strike their testimony based on your perceived,
I didn't say anything about that.
All right, then I'm going to bring the jury back out and you're going to call your next witness. So I'm not hearing a request from you at this time. You said you wanted to raise a legal issue. What's the legal issue?
The legal issue is how is the state allowed to coach the people?
You're assuming they spoke to them and coached them.
It's obvious. I'm not stupid.
Well, I disagree with that, sir. Again, you could ask questions to lay a foundation.
All of a sudden the state don't got
witnesses.
All of a sudden. For the first time in trial, all of a sudden now they don't got no cross. That's clearly a rush to try to get through the case. Hurry up. We just gonna let these people go.
Well, this is argument.
Come on, man.
This is argument on your part, sir. It is pure commentary.
I just want that on the record. I see through it.
And your
see through it
has absolutely no basis in fact.
Yeah, I know that's what's being done.
You
come
could
on,
ask
man.
These questions. You could ask
man.
These witnesses
right
certain questions, and you're
far,
not.
I'm far from an idiot.
They're your witnesses, sir. If you believe
so I'm gonna start asking every witness up here that they seem just to mysteriously now not have any cross for. Have they been coached to answer the way they answer? Because
well, you can't
ask
them if they've met with anyone ahead of their testimony here today, which you've done
funny.
With other witnesses.
I find it very funny that these are their reports, and now all of a sudden you can. Oh, I saw the person in the car. Oh,
right.
But
Mr. Brooks,
I saw them reach for something.
You
oh,
to
I, don't,
delay these
I don't recall what they had on.
Mr. Brooks, there's no purpose for you saying this right
don't
now.
Don't know what they had on? I find that
all
very...
Right. I'm having the jury brought
on,
out. I'm instructing you to
on,
avoid
man.
The commentary when the jury comes
nah,
out or you will forfeit
say,
your right to be
I
present.
I didn't say nothing.
Before
you
do that, there's an issue that we do need to pick up potential as to a witness by the name of Abel Lescano. He has prior criminal history.
Thank you.
So as long as the jury's out, we should probably discuss that. I would like to provide the defendant and the court with a copy.
So that had to be said. So it's the defendant.
That's not how it was said.
That was how it said. You want to run the record back?
Mr. Brooks.
So I'm the only one. One ear that work, and I heard that.
This
on,
is
man.
To benefit on, you so that you
not,
understand
ain't none
your
of this to
witness
benefit me, so let's
has
be clear
a prior
about that.
Record.
Your Honor, when I leave the table, I'm away from the courtroom, and I have to elevate my voice. This is the
so she
alleged
had to
record
her voice
of Abel Lescott.
Stop talking.
Come on, man. Like, I don't know who y'all be thinking y'all fooling. I accept the value in turn for value. This document.
One more interruption and you're going to be removed to the next courtroom.
That's what you want to do anyway.
It's not what I want to do. Do not interrupt Attorney Opper.
So can
Your
you
Honor,
tell,
I
can
believe he has 7 prior criminal convictions via OWI 2nd from 1997, and OWI 3rd from 1997, and OWI 4th from 2003, criminal trespass to dwelling from 2006.
All right, I need to take a break. This man right now is having a stare down with me. It's very disrespectful. He pounded his fist. Frankly, it makes me scared. And we're taking a break. I'd like to continue by bringing the jury out momentarily, Madam Clerk, and having you call your next witness. I trust that you're ready to do that, sir. All right, then.
We need to complete the task.
Oh, we do. I knew I would have left something in my office, but I reviewed it, so go ahead. What is the state's request, then, as it relates to the prior record?
We believe the proper answer would be 7 prior convictions, Your Honor.
All right, Mr. Brooks, do you have a position on the prior convictions for this witness? The state is asking for a determination by this court that there are 7 prior convictions for purposes of questioning the witness, whether that's by you or by them if they so choose. And that would be for a determination under 90609.
What? I don't know what you're asking.
I would direct your attention to, I'm not sure if I see that book out there, but the statute book that I previously provided to you, but that the 90609 would be in there. But in any event, the state is asking that I make a determination about how many for purposes of the questioning of this witness. Do you have any comment, statement, or position on that?
Like it's 9 on here.
Which is the one the state referenced that the charges are listed, but they were dismissed?
2XMBJ, which would be 2 times misdemeanor bail jumping, dismissed and read in. So no convictions from that file.
Oh, why is it on the sheet?
This would be an accurate listing of the cases that you found when investigating the witness's background.
Yes, Your Honor.
And nothing since 2007.
That's correct.
Any statement you want to make, sir, on what the number of convictions this court should consider under 90609?
Should be 8.
The OWI first would not be criminal, as I understand it, and so I believe that's why the state did not ask it that it be counted.
So there's no crime for an OWI?
An OWI first would not be a crime, it would be a forfeiture.
I still would say 8, just based on the fact that there's continued OWIs.
Factors to consider for exclusion include the lapse of time since the conviction, or in this case convictions, the rehabilitation or pardon of the person convicted, the gravity of the crime, the involvement of dishonesty or false statement in the crime, the frequency of the convictions, and any other relevant factors. So based on that, do you have any argument that it should be less than that?
Less than what, 8?
Well, it'd be less than 7. He has 7 convictions as I count them.
And that's not counting OWI first?
Correct, because it's not a crime. It can't be counted under the statute.
Then it's 7. Should be 7.
All right. Do you want to make any argument about whether any should be excluded under the statute?
I don't understand the whole...
Well, for example, the last conviction was in 2007. It's now 2022. So do you want to make an argument to the court that perhaps he's been rehabilitated?
I don't want to speculate on the next man's life. But if it's 7 on here, looks like 7 to me.
All right, then. Anything further from the state on this?
No, Judge, thank you.
So I'll find that for purposes of his testimony that this witness has 7 convictions. He may be asked, have you been convicted of a crime? His answer should be yes. And then the follow-up, how many times? The answer will be 7.
That will have to be told to Mr. Lascano before he testifies, Your Honor, I believe.
I agree. State willing to relay that information?
I'd rather not. Given the accusations levied by Mr. Brooks, I think it's better we do it in open court, Your Honor.
All right. Who's your next witness? Will it be Mr. Lascano? Because if it is, I'll just have him come in now and I can put him on the stand and advise him of that. I'll tell you what, either way, let's just bring Mr. Lascano in case he's not your first, but then I don't have to deal with the interruption with the jury. You don't have to call him first unless you want to, but I'll just bring him in and advise him.
Subject matter jurisdiction, Your Honor.
Court declines to address that.
Still has yet to be verified and proven for the record.
Your objection's noted for the record. Do you want Mr. Lascano on the stand, or are you going to call Mr. Hayes first, just so I know what to do when he comes in?
I don't currently have, I can't find paperwork for Mr. Hayes. Can a police report or something be provided? Case, I want to call Mr. Hayes first.
Yes, we will accommodate that request. It'll just take me a minute, Your Honor, to find it. I'll have to have it printed and brought over, or Mr. Wichow can run.
All right, then, let's have the jury brought out, please.
All rise.
Defense calls, is it Jason Hayes? Jason?
All right. We'll have the witness brought in.
I accept for value and return for value this document for the record. Good afternoon, Mr. Hayes. Is that how you pronounce Hayes?
Yep.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a retail sales associate for a food broker, Damon Worldwide.
Been doing that for a long time?
21 years.
Yes, yeah, a long time. The evening of November 21st, 2021. You recall that evening pretty well?
Fairly well, yes.
What were you doing that evening?
Went to the parade.
Did you go to the parade with family, friends?
Oh, I went there with my daughter.
Were you scheduled to do any marching in the parade itself?
No.
Or just spectate?
Yes.
Anything unusual catch your eye that day that you recall?
Yes.
And what did you see?
Besides the parade?
Yeah, I'm sorry. That was unusual. They caught your eye that evening.
Well, where we were, yes, a red truck came through where we were. It honked and swerved.
I guess I want to back up a little bit. Where were you positioned at that
time? We were all the way at the beginning of the parade.
Okay. What did it swerve from?
I'm sorry?
What did it swerve from?
Where?
Or was it, I guess the correct question would be, why did it swerve?
I don't know. I wasn't driving. I don't know what his intentions were.
And you stated that the vehicle honked. Was that just a single honk, or was it a beep beep, or
one honk?
Do you recall stating that it honked several times?
I don't recall.
When you were initially,
I don't recall.
Did you see where the vehicle went after it honked and swerved?
Yes, it kept on going straight down Main East, the same route the parade went.
Did you get a description of who was driving the vehicle you saw that night?
I did not.
Did you get a license plate?
I did not.
Do you recall if the vehicle had any tinted windows?
No.
And after it continued, I think you said east?
Yep.
Would that be correct? East?
Yep.
Did you see the vehicle strike anyone?
I did not, no.
Do you recall what side of the street the vehicle was traveling on at that time?
It was on the right side.
On the right side. No further questions at this time.
Thank you. Any cross?
Yes, just briefly. Mm-hmm. Good afternoon, Mr. Hayes.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for your attendance, sir. Do you remember writing in your report or telling the police officer that a police officer chased the vehicle on foot?
Objection, leading.
Overruled. It's cross. You may answer.
I do remember that I thought I saw a police chasing after the car on foot.
Okay. And do you remember also telling the same officer that the SUV took off down the street and that it accelerated?
Yes.
Objection.
Is that...
Hold on, there's been an objection.
I guess the objection to be what officer is being referred to wasn't clear.
Overruled. The state may continue asking the question.
I guess I was asking, was that referring to... interview officer?
Your objection is noted. It's overruled. The statement asked the question fully.
Is that your recollection, sir, that the vehicle sped off and accelerated away?
Yes.
Objection speculative.
Overruled.
Do you also recall telling the officer who interviewed you that the driver of the vehicle had a dark complexion and a beard?
Yes.
Is that accurate with your recollection of the driver?
Yes.
But you didn't see a face, you couldn't identify anybody beyond those descriptions, correct?
Hold on. There's been an objection to leading. It's overruled. The witness may answer.
No.
All right, thank you. So those were all my questions.
You made a reference to the driver of the vehicle having a dark complexion? What would you consider a dark complexion?
Dark complexion, I don't know.
It is kind of hard. Did you notice any clothing?
I did not, no.
Did you notice any hair?
No.
No further questions?
All right, thank you. You may step down. And you are excused. The defense may call its next witness, please.
quick question before I do. Who's supposed to be arriving at 3:30? Just so I know.
I'm not sure.
Baby Itz and Urell will be here at 3:30. Mr. Liscano is here now, Your Honor.
Thank you.
I knew he was here now. I was just trying to get clarity.
Are you going to call Mr. Liscano?
It would appear so. He's the one that's here.
All right. Then he may. Defense is calling Abel Liscano, correct?
The defense is calling
Abel
Liscano.
All right. Very well. We'll have him brought in. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Liscano. What do you do for a living currently?
I'm a hairdresser.
No judgment whatsoever on this question. Have you ever been convicted of a crime?
Yes, I have.
And how many times?
7.
Do you recall the night of November 21st, 2021 pretty well? I know it's been a minute, but...
Best as I can, yeah.
What were you doing that evening, if you recall?
The Christmas parade.
Were you marching in the parade? Or?
No, I was watching it.
Who were you there with, family, friends?
My wife and my daughter.
Do you recall where you were positioned to watch the parade?
Standing in front of the Corey Insurance on Main Street.
Okay. Is that part of Main Street close to like a side street? If you recall.
It's not too far from Maple.
Do you recall the side streets being barricaded during the parade?
I don't remember.
You recall something other than the parade catching your attention that day?
People getting hurt, yeah.
And what did you see that day, if you recall?
I saw a red SUV plow over a bunch of people.
Did you see the driver of this SUV you're referring to?
Yeah, you're standing right there.
And how many people did you see in the vehicle?
Just one, the driver.
Do you recall flagging down a law enforcement vehicle that evening?
Yeah, I do.
And do you recall what you told the officer that evening?
Not very well.
I'm gonna attempt to see if anything brings back some recollection. Do you recall telling Officer Moss that you observed 3 or 4 people in the SUV as it passed you?
I don't remember that.
To your recollection, the SUV that you saw, did it have tinted windows?
I don't remember.
And do you remember what the description was that evening that you gave to law enforcement?
I told him it was a red SUV.
The description of the driver, do you remember that?
Yeah, I know he was a black male.
After seeing this vehicle, what did you do?
We left. I got my family out of there.
And where did you go?
We headed back to the car.
And did you see the vehicle stop on Maple Street?
Which vehicle?
The SUV that you claim you saw.
Oh, no, I didn't see it stop, no. It kept going through the parade.
Do you recall advising law enforcement that you observed three black subjects running from the vehicle?
No, I don't remember that.
If it pleases the court, I would like to show the witness this. I'm referring to page 4 exactly.
Is it a statement this witness personally wrote?
I believe it's with, I don't think he wrote it himself.
So it's a summary written by another person?
By, I don't know if it's Officer Moss or Detective Moss. I'm not sure if what his rank is.
Continue with your questions. I'm going to deny the request that you show the exhibit or the paperwork to the witness.
Do you recall making the statements to Detective Moss that you observed one was described as running southbound on Maple towards College Avenue? Do you recall that?
No, I don't.
Do you recall stating that the other two were described as running in a westerly direction from the rear of 338 Maple Street?
No.
Do you recall stating that one black subject was described as tall, wearing a blue top and blue and black pants, while the other subjects were described as two short black males wearing sweatpants?
Barely, a little bit of that.
So, which of these subjects do you minimally recall wearing those items that evening?
No, you asked me if I remember people running, and I said no. I remember describing those people to him. I remember.
So where did you observe those?
Standing by the vehicle.
Just so we have clarity, describe the subjects you saw that evening standing by the vehicle.
I don't remember that good. I mean, you were describing them, so it brought back a little bit, but I can't tell you. That was too long ago.
And how did you come upon the vehicle at the address of 338 Maple Street that evening?
I was walking my family back to the car. Trying to get them to safety.
Do you recall stating that, well, let me back up for a minute. Did you speak with another detective that evening, if you recall?
Yes, I did.
Do you recall if that was Detective Coates?
I don't remember his name.
Do you recall in your interview with Detective Coates that evening, stating that you could not provide any description of the occupants other than that they appeared to be African-American?
Yeah, I remember saying that.
So it'd be fair to say that you observed African-Americans in this vehicle that you saw, correct?
The reason why I came up with three or four people was because when I was walking by and I saw the car, there was two or three black males standing by the vehicle, and there was at least three or four more on the porch. So I figured they were by the vehicle. They must have been the ones trying to hide the vehicle because they were standing in front of it or real close to it.
In reference to seeing the vehicle in the parade as it passed you, do you recall at that point, while at the parade that evening, do you recall stating to Detective Coates that it appeared that there were three or four people in the Ford Escape as it passed you during the parade that evening?
No, I don't remember that.
Any reason why the Detective Coates would report that that's what you stated to him?
Like I said before, I saw two or three people by the vehicle, so I assumed they were with the vehicle. So they must have been in the vehicle during the parade. I saw the driver going by because he hit somebody right in front of us.
And during the parade incident, were you or anyone you were with injured that evening?
No.
No further questions at this time.
Thank you, Annie Cross.
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Lascano.
Good afternoon.
Sir, you said you watched the parade near Curry Insurance, is that correct?
Yeah, right in front.
Okay. Do you remember you said you saw the SUV strike some people in the parade?
Yeah.
Yes. Do you remember what group of people in the parade? Can you remember anything about the name or the banner or the costumes or anything like that?
Objection, leading.
Overruled, Ms. Cross.
No, speculative. Objection.
Overruled. The witness may answer. I believe he said no. His answer may
Yeah, speak. No, I don't remember.
Okay. Do you remember seeing the SUV strike more than one person?
Yes. Objection, speculative.
Overruled.
About how many people did you see the SUV strike, sir?
Objection, speculative.
Overruled.
It was crowds. I mean, when it was coming through, because I was standing over my daughter and my wife, they were sitting on the curb. I saw it coming through, and at first it looked like it was just pushing people out of the way, and then it just kept swerving back, and it was just plowing everybody out of the way until it got to in front of us. Then it actually hit somebody and just did like a cartwheel in the air.
You remember that?
Yeah, it was right in front of us.
Okay. So, Mr. Lascano, I want to talk about the moment when you located this vehicle on Maple, okay? I'm going to ask, Madam Clerk, could you please turn on the AV system? We're going to put up State's Exhibit 65.
Objection to the relevancy of Exhibit 65.
Noted, overruled. It's been received. The State may proceed.
All right. This total clip is 36 seconds, but before we begin to play it, sir, do you recognize the area on the screen that's yeah. shown in this picture?
Yeah, I believe that's Central Middle School.
Where?
Right at where the stairs is.
Okay, the red brick on the left side of the picture?
Yeah.
Objection, okay. Speculative.
Overruled. His answer may stand, he said, I believe.
And would you agree with me the house where the SUV was found was up in this area here where I just put the green dot on the screen?
Yeah.
Objection, leading.
Overruled. You may answer.
Yes.
That looks right. Correct, sir?
Objection, leading.
Overruled.
All right, we're going to clear the screen, please, and we're going to play this entire clip for 36 seconds. Please watch and see if you see yourself or any of your family members in this clip.
Objection to the relevancy of this video to this particular witness.
Overruled. You may play the clip.
Overruled on what grounds, Your Honor? Got a tagging agreement.
Sir, did you see yourself or your family in that clip?
Objection, speculative.
Overruled.
No, I did not.
Okay. Now, you said you did see, by the time you walked past the car, you saw two or three black males standing near the car, right?
Objection, mischaracterization of this. He said three. Specifically said the number.
Overruled.
And you also said you saw two or three, what you thought to be black males on the porch of the residence there, correct?
Objection. He stated it was black males. Asked and answered.
Overruled. The witness may answer.
No.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, there was two or three standing by the vehicle.
Okay. Do you happen to know the people that live at this house?
Objection. Speculative.
Overruled.
No, I do not.
Would it be reasonable, do you think, Mr. Lascano, that people living in the house heard the crash and came outside and that's who you saw standing there by the vehicle?
Objection. There was never any crash mentioned.
I'll sustain calls for speculation.
Mr. Lascano, is it possible that the people you saw standing near the vehicle
were in fact just neighbors that saw the vehicle the same way you did.
Yeah.
You described that at the time you went by on Maple Street, there was a lot of people running around in the area. Is that correct?
Objection, mischaracterization of testimony.
Overruled.
Yes, there was.
And these are people hurrying away from the parade with their families, trying to get to safety just like you were, correct?
Objection, speculative.
Overruled, the witness may answer.
Yes.
You didn't see anything like that in State's Exhibit 65, did you?
No, I did not.
You saw the driver of the SUV in the parade, is that right?
Yes, I did.
And you see that driver present in this courtroom here today, please?
Objection, speculative.
Overrule.
Yes, he's sitting right over there.
Are you sure about that, sir?
Yes.
Objection, speculative.
Overrule.
You said that...
It mischaracterizes the testimony because that was not testified to before on direct.
Oh, your objections are overruled. I believe the witness already answered. Go ahead.
Mr. Liscano, have you and I ever spoken about this case, sir?
No.
What about Attorney Basie here to my right? You and her ever talk about this case or your testimony?
Objection, hearsay.
Overruled.
No.
Mr. Witchell on the end, did you ever talk to him about
objection.
Your testimony, sir?
Objection, hearsay.
Overruled.
No.
All right, thank you, sir. I don't have any other questions.
Thank you. Any redirect?
Yep.
Go ahead.
You stated that you saw the driver, correct?
Yes.
Of the SUV that you saw that day, correct?
Yes.
How did the driver look that day you saw him?
He had a scruffy beard, and he was a black male.
Did you see what the driver was wearing?
No, I don't remember that.
Did you see if the driver had any hair?
I don't remember that either.
Did you see if the driver had anything noticeable about their appearance, tattoos, scars, marks, anything like that?
No. I saw the side, the profile, the side. You were flying fast down that street. I wasn't paying attention to the color of clothes you were wearing. And he was a black male and had a scruffy beard. The first thing I told my wife is he was a black guy driving.
In a couple seconds time, you were able to make out the driver's profile and race just by a couple seconds.
Yeah. It's not hard.
Is that the only person you saw in the vehicle?
From what I remember, yes. I saw the driver.
Were you yourself injured in this incident that evening?
No.
Just for clarification, you already stated previously in testimony that you spoke with two different detectives that evening, correct?
Yes, I did.
And both detectives that you spoke with that evening, the evening of November 21st, 2021, you stated to both of those law enforcement officers, detectives, that you observed three or four people in the SUV.
Like I said before, the reason why I said there must have been three or four was because they were standing by a vehicle. So I assumed that they were with the vehicle. I don't remember seeing them in the vehicle when you were hitting the people.
You stated this to both detectives, two different detectives, the evening of November 21st, 2021. And this was in relation to what you saw from the vehicle at the parade, not where the vehicle was later found. Any reason why you stated to both detectives in relation to what you saw at the parade, why both detectives in their reports stated that you told them that you observed three or four people in the SUV at the time of the parade?
So what's your question?
The question is, why did you report that to two different detectives on the same evening?
Like I told you before, when I walked past the vehicle, I spotted more than one individual standing in front of the vehicle. So I assumed they were with the vehicle. That's why I said they were inside.
I'm sorry.
That's why I said they were in the vehicle. I said there had to be at least three of them in the vehicle. That's the only reason I said that.
We have additional witnesses here?
Yes, Your Honor, they're ready.
All right, would that be how many people?
There's two left.
Okay, so the two left on your list, your next witness, sir.
So I'm guessing that's, I know who it is. Just give me one quick second, Your Honor, one quick second.
Go ahead.
Sorry about that, Your Honor. I'm just making sure I have the correct paperwork. Okay, I'm ready, Your Honor.
Go ahead. Call your next witness.
Kathleen Urell? Urell?
That's how I think it is. We'll find out.
Good afternoon, Miss Urell. Is it Urell?
Urell.
Urell. What do you do for a living?
I'm in workforce management for a call center.
November 21st, 2021, directing your attention there. You recall that evening pretty well?
Off and on, sir.
That's fair, it has been a while. Do you recall what you were doing that evening?
Yes, sir.
And what were you doing that evening?
At what time?
Around 3:30, 4 o'clock-ish.
I was dropping off my children who were participating in the parade.
And did you yourself stay for the parade?
Partial parade, yes.
Partial meaning maybe a few minutes?
Until my group of children went by.
Okay. Do you recall where you were positioned during watching your group participate in the parade?
Yes, on north and east, right on the corner there.
Can you see that on your screen yet?
I do.
Using the touch screen on your screen, can you point out exactly where you were positioned?
When I was watching it?
Yes, when you were watching it.
So it's a touch screen, so use your index finger and you can draw a circle.
Okay.
I was going to say that.
Well, I mean, it was right there. But
I was going to say a circle or a little dot if
Well, I thought I would do it with that.
Yeah.
Oh.
Heavy hands.
Hold it again. So it, press and hold while you drop.
Okay.
And you said that would be approximately East Main and Northeast?
Correct.
There's side streets right there that you can see. Is that fair to say?
Correct.
Do you recall if there were barricades at those?
I can't honestly recall. I can't be sure.
We can take Exhibit 15 down.
Thank you. Go ahead.
And you said you stayed at the parade until your group had passed.
Correct.
And what time did you leave?
I can't determine the time. It was right after my group of kids went by.
And where'd you go from here?
I walked down, well, I went to go get the car because I had to go pick them up at the end of the parade.
Do you recall anything happening at that point?
I think I need more specifics from you to give the details you may be looking for.
While you were getting your vehicle, did you observe anything happening? Did you overhear about anything happening at that point?
So when I left, I walked down Main to White Rock on the corner there. Then a gentleman, a child, who I don't know who they were, and myself walked across the street. And at this time, a car was beeping and weaving around a slight curve that White Rock has, and then continued on.
Did you see where the car went at that point?
Yes, I did. As it came around the slight curve White Rock has, it started to move forward, and then it went straight across when I was thinking it was going to leave the parade route. If you leave the parade route on Main, you're leaving. Sorry, if you turn left, you're leaving the parade route. If you're turning right, you're going right into the parade. And it went right to the, if you're looking at the parade, it was on the right-hand side. And it's continued on into the parade.
I want to back up a little bit. When you first observed this car, as you say, you recall that it was blowing its horn.
Yep, it was. The horn was beeping.
Do you recall if you saw who was operating that vehicle?
Unfortunately, sir, I can't recall.
Do you recall if you might have seen multiple people in the vehicle at that time? Or?
You know, unfortunately, due to the time passing, I cannot recall.
That's fair. It has been a while. Do you recall about what time that was that you observed the vehicle?
Again, I can't be sure.
Sorry if I keep asking.
No, I can't be sure. I'm sorry.
At the time that you observed the vehicle, did you see it strike anyone?
I did not. Or at least I don't recall. I'm sorry.
Did you happen to catch the license plate number of the vehicle at that time?
No, not at all.
Do you recall if the vehicle had any tinted windows?
I couldn't recall, I'm
any
sorry.
Any windows rolled down or up at the time you observed it?
No, unfortunately, I don't remember.
Do you recall if the vehicle passed close to where you were walking at the time?
Yeah, it was close enough that it could have easily had clip me or the two people that were in front of me.
Were you or the two people that you referred to in front of you, were any of you hurt at that time?
No.
No further questions right now.
Hey, Cross.
Yes, thank you. Good afternoon, Ms. Darrell. Thank you for being here. You testified on direct examination that you don't recall whether or not you saw more than one person in that vehicle we're talking about. Remember saying that?
Yes.
You remember meeting on December 2nd, 2021, for an interview with Detective Jay Carpenter from the Waukesha Police Department?
I remember going as to a lot of topic of conversations. I unfortunately can't recall those too clearly.
Do you remember telling Detective Carpenter that you only observed a driver in the vehicle?
Objection, leading witness.
Yeah, I
overruled. You may answer.
I can't be too sure.
Overruled. She may answer.
Can you say that again? I'm sorry.
I can't be too sure. Again, some of the conversations I might have had that day.
Your testimony is that you were standing here on the northeast corner of Buckley and Main Street. Is that right?
Correct. Objection. Already answered that. Asked and answered.
Overruled. She may answer.
You said correct?
Correct. Yeah.
And after your children walked by in the parade, you walked in this direction towards the intersection of White Rock and Main. Is that correct?
Objection.
Correct.
Leading and speculative.
So we'll rule this to both.
Was it clear to you that this was a parade route?
Yes, it was. Very clear.
Was it clear to you that traffic from White Rock should not have driven onto Main Street?
Yes.
Unless they were part of the parade?
Yes.
Did it appear to you as though the vehicle we've been talking about was part of the parade?
No.
How many children do you have, Ms. Urell?
Objection, irrelevant.
Overruled. Man.
Four children.
All four of your kids were marching in the parade that day, weren't they?
Yes.
Objection, leading.
Overruled.
Sorry.
Your oldest daughter, Charlotte, she was 14 at the time?
Yes.
She was marching with the Extreme Dance Group as an alumni, wasn't she?
She was handing out candy.
There was an objection. It's overruled.
I didn't even state why I was objecting, but okay. We still need a 15.
Yes, please. When you were standing in the crosswalk at White Rock and Main, could you see the Five Points intersection?
I could not.
You didn't see your kids get hit, did you?
I did
objection,
not.
Objection, leading.
Sorry.
Overruled.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Objection, hearsay.
Overruled.
You didn't?
I did not.
Did you see them later that night?
Objection, leading.
Overruled. You may answer.
I was only able to see two of my children that night.
You were directly involved in their medical care and the decisions that were made in that process in the days after the parade?
Objection, leading.
Overruled.
Yes, their father and I.
Charlotte suffered a chipped vertebrae from being struck, didn't she?
She
objection,
did.
Objection, leading.
Overruled.
She did.
Your daughter, Alice, she was 10 at the time, wasn't she?
She was.
She suffered chipped front teeth, is that correct?
Yes.
And facial scarring?
Yes.
And road rash?
Yes.
And a broken fibula and tibia?
Yes.
And broken metatarsal bones?
Yes.
She was observed in a concussion protocol, is that correct?
She was.
Your daughter, Vivian, she was marching with the Extreme Dance Group, too, wasn't she?
Yes, she was.
How old was she in November of 21?
She just turned 7.
Vivian suffered a severe concussion, didn't she?
Objection, leading.
Yes.
And road rash?
Extreme road rash.
And a lung contusion?
Yes.
And facial scarring?
Yes.
And your seven-year-old daughter, Vivian, suffered a broken tailbone, didn't she?
She did.
Your son, Grayson, he was 8 on November 21st. 2021, is that correct?
That is correct.
He was walking with the Extreme Dance Group handing out candy, is that right?
He was.
He went to the hospital after the parade, didn't he?
Yes.
He suffered a compound fracture in his femur, is that correct?
An open compound fracture.
Meaning the bone came through the skin?
Yes.
Confession, hearsay. I'll believe he's a doctor.
Overruled, the witness may answer, based upon personal knowledge.
Is that a yes?
Yes.
A police officer saved Grayson's life by placing a tourniquet on that open leg wound, is that correct?
Yes.
I don't have any other questions.
No redirect.
Thank you, ma'am. You may step down. You may call your next witness, please.
We going to take down these exhibitors. He's going to stay up on there.
Oh, thank you. We'll take it down.
So there's one more person here, right?
It's my understanding, sir. Would that be correct, Attorney
yes.
Opper?
Yes.
Defense calls Catrice. I don't know how to say the last name.
Can you give me the spelling that you have?
B-A-B-I-A-S-Z.
I think it's Babias. What's your last name?
Babias.
Babias. All right. Thank you. You are at the witness stand.
Good afternoon, Ms. Babias.
Correct.
I'm surprised I got it right. What do you do for a living?
I am a law enforcement dispatch supervisor.
And how long have you been doing that now?
I've been in law enforcement for 16 years.
The evening of November 21st, 2021, were you on duty that evening?
I was not.
Where were you doing that evening?
I was attending the Waukesha Christmas Parade with my family.
Did anything catch your eye that evening when you were positioned watching the parade with your family?
Yes.
What did you see?
I saw a red SUV coming from White Rock Avenue. The vehicle caught my attention because people started yelling, and the driver was honking the horn.
Do you recall, to the best of your knowledge, it's been a little bit, the driver of the vehicle you observed was honking his horn, was it gesturing to people?
Yes.
And what did you see the gesturing as?
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
What was the gesturing?
What was the driver gesturing?
Yes. I'm sorry.
It's okay. So he was taking his hand and going like this really rapidly.
You yourself being in law enforcement and just based on what you were observing, the driver of the vehicle you observed was honking his horn and gesturing with this motion. Would you take that motion as trying to alert people to move out of the way? Grounds.
Sustain this to the form of a question, please rephrase.
How did you yourself take that gesturing?
I took that gesturing as the driver was telling people to get out of his way.
Back up. Did the vehicle pass pretty close to where you were positioned?
Yes, the vehicle almost struck my daughter.
Do you recall seeing the driver?
I looked the driver right in the eyes.
And how did the driver look?
The driver looked like through me.
What do you mean through you? Describe what you mean by through you.
I feel that it is very hard to explain that look, but it was very frightening.
Do you recall what the driver was wearing?
The driver had a like hoodie sweatshirt or sweatshirt on, and something on his head. I wasn't sure if it was the hood of the sweater or maybe a beanie hat. It was winter. I'm not 100% sure.
Were you able to see any hair?
I did see hair, yes.
How would you describe the hair?
The hair on the head was in front, like dreads down here, from what I could see underneath the hood or the hat. And then there was facial hair.
Are you able to make out a license plate number of the vehicle, being that it had passed so closely by you?
No, once the vehicle continued past my position, I was more concerned about my children that were with me.
At what point were you not able to see the SUV once it passed you?
I lost sight of the SUV once it went into a bunch of people.
The day you spoke with FBI agents, do you recall stating the driver was wearing a red top that appeared to be made out of a sweatshirt-like material?
I don't recall exactly what was said to the agent, but I do remember the sweatshirt, yes.
A red sweatshirt?
It's possible.
Just a little bit ago, you said that, well, when asked the question of did you recall hair for the driver, you stated and made the gesture that the hair was in front. Do you recall saying that?
Yes, sir.
Do you recall when speaking with FBI agents stating that the hair was pulled back?
The hair appeared to be like possibly in a ponytail, but it was so full that it was coming forward.
Were you injured the evening of the incident?
Yes.
You were injured?
Yes, I was.
Any reason why that's not reported?
Probably because I didn't tell anyone else.
If you were injured, why not tell anyone?
Because I haven't wanted to talk about the traumatic experience that I went through for still reliving the weeks and days after the incident.
It doesn't make any sense. You talked to FBI agents a few days where you said you didn't, to be fair, you said you didn't know. You said it was that week is what you said, the same week. You spoke with FBI agents, reported no injuries.
They didn't ask me about injuries.
Well, would it be fair to say that kind of information would come up when talking to law enforcement, seeing as how you yourself work in law enforcement? It just seems odd, don't you think?
I do not. I was not physically injured.
Oh. But you didn't report this at any time whatsoever.
That's the answer to the question.
Grounds.
Sustained. Already answered.
So did you speak to anyone about this? in law enforcement?
Objection, may.
Grounds.
Overruled. She may answer. He clarified law enforcement. Did he speak? Did she speak to anyone about this in law enforcement? I interpreted this as the injury.
Right.
So go ahead.
I feel like, no, I did not.
Did you file any claims related to the incident?
No, I did not.
So today, your first time bringing up your alleged injury?
No, it is not.
At some point, you were subpoenaed by the district attorney's office to testify here, to testify in this trial. Would that be fair to say?
Yes, it is.
Do you recall when you received that subpoena?
From the district attorney's office, it was in July.
You ever spoke with anyone directly at the district attorney's office?
No, correction. Yes, when I walked in today, I met there and let them know I was here, and then they walked me into a room and I waited until I was called by you.
Of the three district attorneys seated to my left at this table, had you had any interactions of any kind with any of those three district attorneys?
I have not.
And I believe, just for the record, when you asked that, Attorney Basie was just pointing to herself and the two people next to her, so it's clear, because since there's two tables.
What would be the reason for that?
Since there's two tables of individuals, I think she wanted to make the witness aware. And I just wanted to point it out for the record since it happened.
Working in law enforcement for 16 years, I'm sure this isn't your first time being involved in a trial. Would that be fair to say?
I have not been in a trial for law enforcement. No, I have not.
You've never witnessed a trial, sat at a trial, been in a trial?
I have not.
Have you ever testified in any way before today?
Objection, Alderman.
Grounds.
Overruled. You may answer.
I have testified before, yes.
So it would be fair to say that you have knowledge of where an alleged defendant and a district attorney would sit in a courtroom, correct?
I know where they're sitting, yes.
While you observed the vehicle approaching your position, did you see it strike anyone?
I did not see the vehicle strike anyone, no.
From your opinion, observing the vehicle approaching your position, did it appear that the vehicle attempted to strike anyone?
Yes.
And why would you come to that conclusion?
Because I saw an officer have to jump out of the way in order for the...
When it was approaching.
When it was,
approaching. I'm confused. Hold on, everyone. The question was asked. This witness is going to be allowed to answer the question fully without interruption. Go ahead and answer the question.
Thank you. I misunderstood his question, I guess.
Answer the question okay. That as you understood it.
Yep. So I saw that... an officer have to get out of the way, and he was attempting to stop Mr. Brooks from driving through the parade, and he was at the last minute jumped out of the way from the vehicle. Otherwise, he would have been struck.
You just used the name Mr. Brooks for the first time that you've been testifying. Would that be fair to say?
I don't understand your question.
You just used the name Mr. Brooks for the first time since you've been testifying. Is that fair to say?
That's fair to say, yes.
Why haven't you used that name before? You've been up there for quite some time.
I didn't need to.
So what changed for the last question that you needed to?
I don't understand your question.
You just stated that you didn't mention the name before because you didn't need to. So what about the last question that you answered made you feel like you needed to use the name for that question and no question before that?
I don't know.
Out of curiosity, how did you come to the knowledge of that name?
It was on the subpoena I received last week.
You just stated a little bit earlier in your testimony that you received your subpoena in July. Now you said last week.
Those are both correct.
So you received two separate subpoenas?
Correct.
What was the difference between the two?
One was from the district attorney's office and one was from you.
So the one that you received from the district attorney's office in July didn't have a case caption on it?
What's a case caption?
Just one second. One second, Your Honor.
Your Honor, just to object to this line of questioning. I really don't know what the relevance is for the purposes of this trial.
There was no objection at first.
But there's no.
I'm going to sustain the objection under 906.11 because I don't believe it advances.
I think you know where I was getting at with the question.
Then you need to ask your question directly, sir. Go ahead. But I'm sustaining it as to the form of the question.
When you were subpoenaed in July by the district attorney's office, the subpoena didn't contain information to the case you were being subpoenaed for?
Objection to relevance.
Grounds.
Sustained. You don't have to answer that. I sustained the objection on that. Those grounds. Ask the question I believe that you're trying to ask, not that one.
Was the name that you mentioned, Mr. Brooks, anywhere on the subpoena that you received from the district attorney's office in July?
Objection. Relevance.
Grounds.
Oh, sustained.
Grounds for the sustained.
Not relevant. Name.
What? Mind-boggling. Sir, in July, when you received your subpoena from the district attorney's office, were you even aware what you were being subpoenaed for?
Objection, relevance.
Grounds.
Sustained. Not relevant.
She's testifying in a trial and it's not relevant that she got subpoenaed?
Mr. Brooks, she's here under your subpoena.
What?
You called her as a witness.
The subpoena. It's relevant because she was already subpoenaed.
Mr. Brooks, under 906.11, please ask the witness a relevant and probative question.
This is mind-boggling. Mind-boggling.
Remind the jury that the statements of the parties or the attorneys are not evidence.
So were you aware that it was a chance you would be possibly testifying in this trial?
Yes.
And did you know who the trial was for?
Objection.
Grounds.
Sustained.
Grounds for sustained.
It's not relevant.
I've never heard of nobody testifying in a trial that they didn't know who the trial was for.
Mr. Brooks, I'm sustaining the objection under 90611, and I'm asking you to move on.
Man, y'all, this is ridiculous, man. Seems to me like a lot of your answers are coached. Is that fair to say?
No.
So the subpoena that you got last week, is that how you learned the name that you used?
Objection. Relevance
grounds.
For the same reason I argued before.
Grounds.
Asked and answered. She's indicated the answer already. 90611, sir. Next question.
The question was, is that the first time that she saw the name?
It's not relevant.
That
next
was
question.
Not asked and answered. That was not asked nor answered.
Under 90611, please ask a question, sir.
Man, what is y'all people trying to pull, man? This is ridiculous.
Mr. Brooks, if you don't ask another question that's relevant and probative under 90611, then I will turn the witness over to the state for their cross-examination.
And then I should be able to get redirect, right? Your Honor?
Ask a question, or I will declare the examination by you to be ended.
It's not an examination, it's direct.
It's a direct examination, sir. Under 90611, you are directed to ask a question, or I will
ask the state if they have any questions. I heard you.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Know who the plaintiff is in this matter?
Yes.
Who's the plaintiff?
The state of Wisconsin.
Is that an entity or a living human being?
Objection.
Grounds.
Not relevant. Sustained. Next question.
Have you ever had any interaction with the plaintiff?
Objection. Vague.
Sustained.
Vague.
As to the form of the question.
Have you ever had any interaction with the state of Wisconsin?
Do not answer that question. Next question, sir. Under 90611.
Is there an objection or was that just a ruling? I'm not sure. You're both was talking at the same time.
Under 90611, I directed the witness not to answer that irrelevant question. Ask your next question, sir. Mr. Brooks? Ask your next question.
I'm gonna get to it.
Thank you.
So when did you first report your alleged injury?
You do not have to answer that question. Next question, sir.
Grounds for
90611, sub 1, sub A, sub B, and sub C.
Is that lawful law?
All right. You may sit down. Does the state have any questions for this witness?
Ma'am,
that day on November 21st of last year, you were there with two kids?
I was, yes.
What were their ages on that date?
Objection.
Three and...
Overrule the witness may answer.
Of course it's going to be overruled.
Three and six.
I don't know. Mr. Brooks, it's Adele. I'm kind of asking the questions right now.
Mr. Brooks, please sit down. Mr. Brooks, you're not asking the questions.
I'm not saying
anything. I would ask you to sit down, please. It is disrespectful to this witness and to the state and to the court.
No, it's not. Not doing anything wrong. I'm merely standing here.
Yeah, when you were at the parade on November 21st of last year, approximately where were you watching the parade from?
Ask the answer to objection.
Mr. Brooks, it's cross-examination. Just because you asked the question initially and she answered does not mean the state doesn't get to follow up on it.
So the state can ask the same question I asked?
The state can ask their question.
So how come when I did that,
the witness may answer.
I was on Main Street, but right by where the intersection of White Rock, and I was in the roadway.
I'm going to show you what's been marked and previously admitted into evidence as State's Exhibit 15. Would be fair to say is to your left would have been Pleasant Street?
That is correct.
Were there barricades blocking Pleasant Street?
There were barricades that were partially blocked. They were on Main Street, but partially blocking Pleasant Street as well.
Could a car have gone down Pleasant Street?
Yes.
Objection.
Okay.
Overruled. Hearsay. The witness may answer. It's not hearsay.
So when the red SUV came down White Rock Avenue and was making its turn onto East Main Street, as you've testified, it could have just gone straight onto Pleasant Street, correct?
Objection. That is correct.
It's hearsay. She's speaking as
eyewitness. Mr. Brooks, your objection is noted. It's overruled. The witness may answer.
It's always overruled.
Go ahead, you may answer, ma'am.
Sorry, there's a lot of talking. Your question was, just to clarify, could the vehicle have gone straight onto Pleasant Street? Is that right?
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Okay, thank you. And where you stated that you and your kids were partially in the roadway when the red SUV came through?
Yes, we were.
Objection. That's mischaracterization of what was testified to.
Overruled. The witness may answer. Go ahead.
Give me an answer.
Can you repeat it?
Sure. Were you and your kids all in the roadway when the red SUV went through?
Yes, we were.
And was one of your kids going to get candy when the red SUV came through?
Yes,
my daughter. Objection. Speaking as a firsthand eyewitness.
Because she is a first-hand eyewitness.
No, I'm talking about you.
The objection is noted. It's overruled. The question is proper, and the witness may answer.
Yes, my daughter was further in the roadway. We were all on the road, but she was further in the roadway, reaching to grab candy.
Had your daughter gone to get candy at other times?
The entire time.
Had she, during the time preceding the red SUV coming through, had she almost been struck by any other participants in the parade?
No, she was nowhere near where the vehicles were driving through the parade.
So she's going out to get some candy that had been thrown, I assume, correct?
Yes.
And
overruled, the witness's answer may stand.
And you see this red SUV coming. Is it coming from your right or from your left?
The red SUV was coming from my right side, which was White Rock.
Okay. And how close did it come to your daughter?
It was, I wouldn't be able to give an accurate judgment, but it felt very, very close.
Had you not pulled your daughter away, would that car have hit your daughter?
It's actually speculative.
Overruled.
It's very possible.
Thank you. So you say that you saw a police officer have some contact with the red SUV. Do you recall that?
Yes.
Can you describe that for the jury?
Well, there was a few times that police officers attempted to stop the red SUV. The first one would have been where we were on Main and White Rock. And then there were also other people trying to stop it too. And then again, as it drove, once it turned onto Main, the next road, I believe is Buckley. And there was another officer who tried to stop that, the red SUV again.
And ma'am, as the car passed your location, did it increase its speed?
Yes.
Do you know where in the roadway it traveled down?
Overruled. The witness may answer.
The direction of travel?
Where in the road? Was it on the left-hand side, the right-hand side, or in the middle?
It was all over the road.
You saw it all over the road?
Yes.
So going, and why don't you describe for the jury what you saw?
Driving the vehicle, once it turned onto Main, it drove side to side, and then I lost sight when there were through the people as it got down the hill.
Nothing further.
Thank you. Let me read the red card.
You said you observed multiple officers try to stop the vehicle. Is that correct?
Yes.
Describe one at, I think you said it was Buckley, right?
Yes.
Why didn't you report the other officers that you allegedly saw attempt to stop the vehicle?
I don't know what you're asking.
The report that you interview that was conducted with the FBI. Why is it not in the report about the multiple officers that you say you saw attempting to stop the vehicle?
I don't know why that wasn't put in the report.
Do you recall if you told the FBI agents?
It's been a year. I believe so, but it's been a year.
When you say it's been a year, I'm assuming that means that there's some details you don't quite recall all the way. That'd be fair to say?
Yes.
So it would be fair to say that if there's details you don't recall, how can you recall the path to travel of the SUV that you claim you saw?
Can you rephrase the question? I'm not understanding.
I think it was clear, but I'll ask again. You just acknowledged that there may be some details that you don't quite recall. So would it be fair to say that you don't quite recall the path of travel of the vehicle?
No, that is not correct.
Judging by what you just stated, wouldn't it be fair to say that that's a possibility?
No.
So you recall all the details of what you observed that evening, November 21st, 2021?
No.
So what other details do you not recall?
Objection, Your Honor. How does someone recall the details that they don't recall?
Yeah, that's what I wonder.
Sustained is to the form of the question.
Seems very funny. Seems almost as if you're recalling what you want to recall and purposely not
Objection. Badgering the witness.
Yes. Sustained. You do not have to answer that, and you are warned. You may not badger or argue with this witness. Next question.
Badger or argue? What do you mean?
Next question.
What do you mean?
Don't intimidate the witness is what I mean.
How am I intimidating the witness?
Badgering the witness by eye rolling, by pursing your lips, by making facial movements regarding her answers.
Does she feel intimidated?
Is badgering the witness.
Are you kidding me?
Under 90611, really please ask
you really
your next question.
You can't be serious right now. Intimidating the witness. What have I done to intimidate the witness?
The last question was badgering, which is a form. Can
you say, but you said,
Mr. Brooks, I've made my ruling under 90611. Please ask a question or I will stop the questioning.
How did I intimidate?
Under 90611, sub 1, sub A, sub B, and sub C, ask your next question or the questioning of this witness will end.
How are you even a judge? How are you even a judge?
All right, you may step down, ma'am. Thank you.
How are you even a judge? Come on, man. This must be all about the 62 trust, right? That you want to be the beneficiary of?
I'm going to give the jury their closing instruction. We are done with testimony for today. Please do not begin your deliberations and discussion of the case until all the evidence is presented. And I have instructed you on the law. Do not discuss this case among yourselves or with anyone else. It also extends to all forms of electronic communications. Relying on this information is unfair because the parties would not have the opportunity to refute, explain, or correct it. Do not communicate with anyone about this trial or your experience as a juror while you are serving on this jury. Do not use a computer, cell phone, or other electronic device, including personal wearable electronics, applications, or tools with communication capabilities to share any information about this case. Decide the case solely on the evidence offered and received at trial. I'll have the jurors report on Monday at 9 a.m. Thank you. You are excused. Please rise for the jury.
You even gonna call yourself a judge as much as bias you put up in here. Don't even tell the jury the truth. You got no integrity whatsoever. None.
Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. I would like an update on whether Mr. Brooks filled out a subpoena for Don Woods and provided that to the state. Has that been done?
No, we haven't received anything, Your Honor, and our position would be, Your Honor, that we will not be responsible in any fashion for producing Miss Woods. Mr. Brooks talks to her on a daily basis. If he wants her here, he can produce her on Monday.
Yeah, they ain't got to worry about that.
So I just wanted to know, because I know a subpoena form was filled out.
If I want her to be here, she going to be here.
I agree with
so
the
just,
state
just
that.
Just know that.
She could certainly appear.
It ain't even got to be no arrangement. All I got to say is come. She don't come. That simple.
Mr. Brooks, do you intend to call her as a witness? Because I'm directing you to
said,
have her here
said
at
all
9 a.m.
We said all that at the beginning, man. Like, I don't even want to be in here that much longer. Just do what you got to do so I can get up out of here. I'm tired of being in the courtroom that has no integrity whatsoever. How can you even call yourself
Mr.
a judge?
Brooks, I need to make a record of
I need
things.
To make a record, too.
You don't.
When
need
am
to...
I going to get the chance to do that?
All right. I need to make a record. He's being removed to the other courtroom. He is yelling at me. He's not going to let me make a statement or make the record that I need to make. He hasn't sat down for the better part of 2 hours.
All you want. You can hold me in contempt all you want.
I'm not holding you in contempt.
If it's criminal or civil, so I can hit you with you.
I need to clear the courtroom because I do need to make.
I'm going to give you what you know is coming.
I need him to go to the other courtroom because I do need to put some things on the record. The record should reflect
the contract between you
that
and I?
Mr. Brooks
if it's
is
criminal,
yelling at me.
What is the crime?
He is.
Who makes the claim? And what is...
I will make the record when we get back. I will step off, but Mr. Brooks, you're being taken to the next courtroom.
Mr. Brooks, don't try to address me like that, like we cool. You don't have no integrity. How can you even call yourself a judge? Making tacit agreements, being biased, judicial misconduct, trying to steal somebody's system. Am I muted?
To reflect that Mr. Brooks is in the adjacent courtroom. I have verified the audio and video are working appropriately. I need to address some scheduling issues, but before I do that, I need to make a record that at the very end of, after I read the closing instructions, Mr. Brooks started to make disparaging remarks about the court in the presence of the jury. I did not respond to those. And once that jury left, he got incredibly loud. He was yelling at me. He, I think, had been standing for the better part of the last couple of hours, even though at one point I directed him to sit down after the direct examination of the last witness. I would just remind him that this was a witness he called, therefore it's proper and allowable under the law, under 906.11, sub 3 to be exact, for the state to ask leading questions. He continued to stand. He was being very argumentative with that witness who, again, he called. I did provide permission to him earlier today, if he so chooses, to call Dawn Woods as a witness. The only other witness at this point that I can identify that's been, for which there is, for which the court and the state has been put on notice, of course, would be Mr. Brooks himself. Given how this trial has progressed, and the disruptions and some of the issues with, excuse me, consent or lack of consent or that Mr. Brooks sometimes raises. I'm also going to advise him today that failure to answer the question on what is your decision, a failure to answer, this court will interpret as a no, meaning he is he will be choosing not to testify and the jury will be so instructed. Once the evidentiary phase of the trial is closed, of course, I will be sending the jury home because I do anticipate a very lengthy jury instruction conference. It's my hope that if that is something we can get done by the end of the day on Monday, but since it's just the parties and not a jury here, I will go as late as it takes with the hope of and with the plan of, again, assuming the state doesn't call any rebuttal witnesses, to start instructing the jury on Tuesday morning. I anticipate that is going to be an incredibly lengthy process.
So for the record, I think it's important to note that the two photographs the defendant attempted to show that witness and presumably put into evidence depicted what I believe to be the defendant and Ms. Patterson's 15-year-old daughter, as well as their new grandchild, the daughter's child, who was born around May 1st of 2022. I think that there was ample grounds for the court to end Ms. Patterson's testimony when it did, but for just in case that becomes an issue going forward, I'll make an offer of proof that Ms. Patterson, if asked about those pictures, would have testified that she did not provide them to Mr. Brooks. She provided them to a person named Michelle, who I believe is a mutual friend, who in turn provided them to Dawn Woods, the defendant's mother, long day, that was the person who provided them to Mr. Brooks. If she were forced to answer questions about this supposed letter that Mr. Brooks was claiming to exist, she would have testified that she has not written a letter to Mr. Brooks since he came into our jail on November, well, November 22nd. She didn't write one on November 21st either. At any point between his being taken into custody and today, it's my understanding that he has tried to call her from the Waukesha County Jail on 37 occasions. She has never accepted a single one of those phone calls. And finally, during the early lunch break, I was informed by the bailiff staff that the defendant was twice offered to go to his cell to retrieve that letter that he talked about. He declined both times.
Thank you. I appreciate the record being made. I will now unmute Mr. Brooks and ask him if there's anything he needs to make a record of at this point on the topics that have been raised. So is this anything you wish to address before we break for the day?
Yeah, I can. I wasn't really hearing everything that was just said good, but why haven't I been given the chance to offer all my filings and the evidence when I already stated that before?
I would like
all my filings. I would like every single filing that I filed placed into evidence, every last one of them. That has yet to be done. I put you on notice, and I've stated it on the record, even before I even had a chance to start calling witnesses and put on a defense that I haven't even been adequately been able to do. So this is something that's been stated on the record numerous times. I did hear a reference to Whatever he was just talking about, in regards to me going to get the letter or whatever the case may be. First of all, it's not just one letter. Like I stated before, it's multiple letters. And for somebody that don't even know to try to tell me what I got, like, you need to cut it out, man. Y'all need to cut it out. Seriously. Stop it. It seems to me that all y'all been wanting to do is gang up. Be biased, be prejudiced, and gang up. Four against one. You sit up there earlier and made a record before the lunch. You sit up there and made a record about all this stuff that happened in Nevada. That's other acts of evidence, ain't it? How was you allowed to put that on record and not even be truthful about everything that you said? But not one time did somebody say, no, we gonna strike that. Not one time. But if it had been me, it would have got struck. Or if it had been me, it would have been a problem. If it had been me, I'd have been held in contempt. Why was the bond not addressed? Why was the statement of particulars not addressed? No filings that I seem to file need to be addressed. After you sat there and told me that that's what I needed to do, do you want to refer to the waiver of counsel, which, again, for the record, you accepted it the way that I gave it to you, which clearly states on there, I do not waive my right to assistance of counsel, and you accepted that. But you still turn around and continue to violate my Sixth Amendment right.
violate my First Amendment right by telling me what I can and can't say, which I have the right to say whatever I want to say and to be heard. That's the First Amendment. You sit up here and talking about a fourth option that you came with out of the blue for Illinois versus Allen when there is no fourth option. Then you try to sneak some other case laws in that you just came up with today. I don't know if you came up with that when you was on one of your breaks that you take, but that it's awful funny that it never got mentioned before. You've repeatedly made a false record. You wanna sit up here and perpetuate all this disruptive behavior and this, that, and the third, when you knew from the point of the start of this trial, one, that I wasn't prepared, two, that I did not understand the proceedings. But yet still, you choose to find a way to get around it. Just like you found a way to get around answering what your name was, which you're a public servant, the name that you have on file with the Secretary of Treasury and State, however you want to put it. You were asked for a certified copy of your oath of office, which you stated on the record you would not provide. Didn't give any case law why you don't have to provide that. Have yet to prove subject matter jurisdiction. For the record, have yet to show that you even have a license to practice law. Haven't proven that yet. And neither has the prosecution. Where's the licenses? Why can't I place your oath of office into the record? Why can't I make that part of evidence? The oath that you haven't even honored, not one bit. Doing enough to keep your face clean doesn't constitute being fair, doesn't constitute being impartial. When the jury was selected, I struck the whole jury. That never got addressed in any way, shape, or form. When you knew, when you were informed way before that I was striking the whole jury. So how can you go over that constitutional right, which I have the right to not pass the jury?
Mr. Brooks, I'm muting you. And the reason I'm muting him is because he has not addressed a single issue that was raised at the end of this hearing today. He is simply rehashing previous determinations of this court. I would describe it as a rant. He continues to impugn the integrity of this court and this process. Again, he did not address any of the issues that I raised at the end of this hearing. From my perspective, the issues that he is raising are all related to claims that a sovereign would make, someone who claims to be a sovereign citizen, claims that have no base, that are baseless in law and in fact. I'm not going to address them any further. Again, they are simply baseless. And with that, I'm going to end for the day. I'll see the parties at 8:30 a.m. on Monday. Thank you, everyone. We are in recess.